Namaskar, I'm Ashok Vyas, and today in Wide Angle with Ashok Vyas, I'm so delighted and happy to be welcoming someone who is creatively, passionately working towards making this world a better place, beautiful place through colors and through designs. I have the pleasure of welcoming someone. She is recognized for her ability to create, to think differently, and to work in ways which brings claps from various sources. Smrita Jain joins me today. Smrita ji, namaste.
Namaste.
You are a designer, you are an artist, you are an activist. When you look at the mirror sometimes and you ask this question, who am I? What is the answer that comes?
I always say I want to be a creative person. I love to be I recognize as a creator, it doesn't matter whether I'm creating a design piece or an art piece or writing or thinking. It's just about creating something different, thinking uniquely, creatively, implementing it differently, using colors, using photography, combining various skills together. That's what I love to do, and that's what I want to be remembered as.
Smrita, your name itself tells me and assures me that you'll be remembered the way you want to be remembered. Smriti word literally translates as memory, and Smrita is again a creative way of making use of Smriti, I must say. Let me understand a little bit about your way of perceiving the essence or the substance or the juice or the meaning of creativity. And when you look back, when you figured out that this is your calling?
So I think after high school in Delhi, that's when my father and my grandfather, they both expected me to be lawyers. Mm-hmm. And coming from a conservative traditional family, these are like the sought after careers that people think about, an accountant and lawyer, a very typical way of having a career for anyone. But I decided not to do it, and I had to fight over it to get into a creative field. And luckily we had a lot of these conferences and seminars where we were showcased how design is being implemented in fashion, in animation, in Hollywood movies. And so that kind of brought a lot of interest in designing. And I felt like I want to do something where I can combine design and art, and what kind of skills I can pick up in order to produce that kind of work. So it was right after my high school that I decided that I want to get into art and creativity. But because of the family pressure, I actually got into political science, and I started my career in political science. But then it didn't feel right. It just didn't feel right. It didn't feel happy. And I felt that and even though I was doing my painting and drawing lessons at home, it was the formal thing that started was at APJ Institute of Design. And during my political science undergraduate, I switched over to design and art. And I've been in design and art ever since then.
Wonderful. So this is such a proud feeling that you chose the path that you felt was right.
Yeah.
That's like singing your own song, and also fighting to be able to sing your song. So the mental state of a creative being, typically we hear that art and harmony go together, but sometimes artists have to stand up and fight for what they feel is right, or to be able to make the choice which resonates with their inner calling. So how that plays out eventually, as per your experience?
It didn't happen overnight for me. It's a process. It was a process for me. And over the years, struggling to get work, It's not a very good thing to blame the economy every time, but it does affect, economy does affect how we think, how we work, and art is also, it gets affected by how the society is in an economic field. So it was a process, and I realized that as I was experiencing these big, huge moments of failures and achievements, both, it was coming out as art for me. It was the more I was representing and creating art, the better forces of nature were, you know, coming towards it. So this was a process. It was not an overnight thing.
And so, as you mentioned, combining different ways of expression, be it design, painting, writing, and I would also say now you are probably a very different kind of a speaker who brings sensitivity and issue-based awareness to the table. How it blends with the need to creatively express.
Yeah, so for me, it's very important to first narrow down what the subject is, what you want to say. For me, topics interest me more. Whether I execute it in a painting form, or if I go to a conference, let's say Global Status of Women and Girls Conference in Virginia, and I speak about it, or I teach a class about it. It's more about the issues. It's more about the subjects and the topics and how it comes, in what format it comes out, whether it's photography or a book or a painting or an exhibition or a collaborative way of working with other artists as well. It's just a mere execution at that point. So it's more about focusing on what you want to say, what you want to say, when and where you want to say, and then you decide how you want to say it.
So. And once you have said it, the kind of impact which you wanted to create, whether you succeeded in doing that or not, also becomes a part of your experience. And now let's move towards your exhibition experience. So when you create one painting, it's a unique sense of joy and satisfaction, I believe. But when all these paintings put together in a series, the way you chose them to be seen by people, is displayed, that is another high, is it?
Yeah, I think curation of your own art is very important. And I think a lot of artists are very particular about how their painting has to be seen, how their painting has to be viewed, whether it's in a gallery space or if it's outside on the road as a public art. And I think artists are curators on their own. They are curating how it has to be displayed, how, what has to come next, what comes first, how the story is being displayed, whether you're writing the type on the floor, or it totally depends on how artists want to, how it wants it to be viewed. So I think that little bit of curation, every artist has it. But a lot of them are like, I work with many artists as well. I have an online art gallery it's an artist collective gallery, so I try to take a lot of inputs from other artists as well, and I'm very particular about, and I always ask them when we're doing pop-up shows, how you want your art to be displayed. You know, they're very, and some artists are like, you know what, I'll let you decide, you're the curator. So totally depends on how the artist is looking at their own work.
No, the way you look at your own work, and there are some experiments, I would say,
yeah,
with your childhood impressions which are flowing with you, and I think one of them is right behind me as we speak. Is it that tippy-tippy tap-tap art installation?
Yes, it's a paper origami art installation. It's a Japanese origami art, and it's a game that I used to play in school. I'm sure that it's still being played, But the
is it tippy tippy tap tap is what, like you fold and
it's an origami. So you fold the paper and then you write colors on it or just random things, and you make up a story that if you choose red, then bad things will happen to you, or if you choose green, you will get money, or if you choose blue, then you will have a vacation in ocean. So it was just used to be a fun game, and it was all about, oh, what is in your luck? You know, what is based in your luck? But like I said, over the years, the kind of experiences that I had, both failures and achievements, I realized that life is not about luck. It's just 0.999% of what luck is. It's sheer hard work. And that's when I literally sat with paper and pen and I sketched out what I want to say. And I thought of this game as one of my ways to tell people that life is about each moment, every moment coming together in different colors. Yellow for happiness, red for anger, like all these different colors are coming together to make your life. Life is not about luck, it's about hard work. It's about how much you put in, your efforts you put in, and that's what the installation is all about. And it was a very tedious installation when I did. It took me about 6 to 7 weeks to complete. But this installation is very fluid in nature, so it can go bigger or smaller. It can take any format, and that's how life is. No matter how much you put in, it'll take any form the way you want it and how you direct it. So that's what life is all about. So it was just a fun installation that I did at one of our pop-up exhibitions.
So it is very, very interesting and sort of insightful to hear your take on life with very little percentage given to luck. We hear most of the time people say it's all luck, or it's all predetermined or design, but the way with artistic sensibility you have reached to the conclusion that it is how you do it, it is hard work, and you probably experience it that way also, or
absolutely. This was not purely luck. I had to work my way from convincing my parents to my professors to my professors at Pratt Institute to my colleagues in my workspace now. And it's a challenge every day. It's there's a lot of competition for designers and artists, and you have to thrive in that competition. So definitely not luck, but I do feel that if whatever you choose in life, if you do what really matters to you, you will excel in it no matter what. You know, even if you do something in a very small scale base, I think it'll still be very successful at one point.
Very inspiring words coming from Smrita. And Smrita, let's go to London with you, where you were present for a conference, London conference, that was Kaleidoscope of Art and Design.
Yes.
It
was a 2-day creativity conference. It was held at Nehru Place. It's actually an art division of High Commission of India. And there is another Nehru Center in Mumbai, and this Nehru Center was in London. So they do have branches all over the world. And they do these exhibitions and conferences and talk shows. So when I went there, they were very fascinated with the work Creating Durga. And it was perfect time because it was September, and that's when the Durga was actually happening in India. So I got a lot of feedback. A lot of people came from London, and London is I always say London is like another India. You know, I'm sure you would agree. But there's so many Indians out there. They know the culture so well, and I had so many people who were so happy to see the project in that format because they were like, oh, I feel like I'm at home. I feel like I'm back in India. So that made me feel very happy. It made me feel so happy to have, to bring that authenticity of Indian culture in a different land altogether. And I feel like it that made the project very successful because you want to be authenticate in your work and original and be different and unique at the same time. So, and the second day conference had our speaking engagements. So I had two other speakers, Lauria Gracia and Alok Nayak. Both of them spoke about sound and art and Indian classical music and how they're combining with the Western music. And my subject was more about the visual design and art and how these two are coming together. So I used my own case studies. I used one of my Incredible India project as one of the case studies and how the idea is to break away the stereotypical thinking of Indian culture. When we think about Indian culture, it's about temples and all these old monuments and cows on the road and camels and all these very typical touristy images that come Bollywood dances. And I felt like India is so much more about it. India is so much about languages. And each language is so visually different and so visually beautiful. I mean, the way the characters of Hindi characters are, the way the Tamil characters are, the way Bengali characters, the way these languages are not just spoken but written so visually different, there is so much art in it. And we don't display it at a higher level, we don't display it in the mainstream level. And I feel like that is where the push has to come. And as a visual artist, I feel I can bring that push. And that's what I'm trying. I did a team typeface as one of my attempts to bring the Hindi lettering and the Hindi typeface designing into more mainstream and artistic level, not just, oh, India is about 30 languages. I don't even know how many languages India has. There's so many. But yes, it has so many languages. But what next? You know, it's written so differently. Let's see it. There is some art form around it that we have to explore. And that's what I'm trying to do.
So I'm happy that you explored the art form from the way the look of letters of different languages is. And it's refreshing when you see differently, and I think art is all about helping you see your life differently, appreciate more of it than what you have done so far. And talking about appreciation and art sensibility, the impact or impressions and influence of culture becomes a part of you without 100% being aware of it. So in your case, the sensibility and understanding and appreciation of Indian culture that has come with you, and then what you have learned here in America, how they coexist. Sometimes do you see that there is an interesting mix which is being expressed through you because of the flow of these two distinctly identifiable rivers of cultural influences?
Yes. So New York is a place of opportunities, and there's no doubt about it. There's no question to it. And the kind of professors that I had, they really encouraged me to do projects that have a little bit of influence of Indian culture in it. They really saw that I can bring that link. And when I tried it once, I tried it again. So now that even the design project, like a team typeface was a design project, but now I'm branching out into art. I'm branching out into making 3D silk screen posters out of that. With and my goal would be to actually make that as part of a book eventually. And the book Fat Free Samosa is also another attempt to make.
So you're working on a new book, which is fat-free samosa. And that is something which would make everybody smile. Fat-free samosa. Talk to me about it.
It's very fun. It's not just smile. People actually laugh the moment I tell them fat-free samosa, because samosa can never be fat-free. It's one of the fattest dish. It has so much oil, so much fat. And that's the whole point, that I'm stripping down the facts. I'm stripping down literally the three things that this samosa represents, which is mind, body, and soul. The shape of the samosa is very iconic, right? It's a pyramid. It's like a three edges to it. So everybody recognizes it. You go to London, you go to Paris, you go to anywhere, Cairo in Egypt, and they know what samosa is. They know what an Indian samosa is. So it's very Indian, typical, iconic dish. And I'm talking about how we can strip down the facts of mind, body, and soul of what our Indian culture is all about, and experiences coming from a woman, experiences coming from a conservative family, and how progressively we can think. And that's what I mean, is taking down all the fat, taking down all the grime, removing all these issues that keep women so constrained, is what fat-free samosa is all about.
Oh, man. So it's so conceptual. It has so much depth. So
yes,
much
it is very conceptual. And I have explained this in my book as I'm writing, because I feel like a lot of people won't understand it in the first, because it's never been heard. People don't think about samosa as fat-free, and to think about it as the title of the book is also very surprising to them.
And samosa is also surprised that you looked so philosophically at its size, way it looks. And I think you came up with novel interpretation of what one can perceive from the shape of a samosa. Yeah. Claps.
I'm actually, I want to make a series of a couple of artworks as well with that. With the samosa. It's still in my head right now. I have to execute it right now. But that's how I think. I have ideas in head. I write them down, I jot them down, and then I visually kind of mold them to see how I can execute them.
Talking about execution and talking about the need to stand sometimes, and your life is a testimonial that you stood by where you felt lied the sense of right for you. Now, making use of your ability to express creatively to empower the voice related to certain issues, and especially about making society more gender sensitive.
I feel like, not just combining work with other artists, I also teach. And I will be teaching at Global Status of Women's Conference, and I'll be doing a talk show there. And before that, I'll be teaching a class on gender and art. It's a class by Professor Dawn Hutchinson. And I think that is the way to do it. It's spreading the awareness through your work and then teaching the next generation. And I do feel it's hopeful, because it is in their hands at the end to carry forward what you are imparting their knowledge, the knowledge to them. So they have to learn how to solve problems, and not violently, but creatively. And that's another way of looking at, like, Fat-Free Samosa book is one of those projects that's actually branching out into activism, activism field, so trying to bring a social change. But I feel like there's so many things I cannot say in public. There's so many things I cannot speak out loud, because someone will feel offended by it. And we are living in such a sensitive environment right now. So I feel like having a book, having it written down, having it saying it in a subtle way, will probably help make that understanding better than making people offended by it. So I definitely feel hopeful.
Thank you very much, Smrita. I think that is another encouraging part about her creative expression. There is a sense of openness and innovative approach towards art, as well as combining a different medium to express, including writing, graphic designing, making use of digital tools also, and indeed the simple paint and brush. So all goes well in the journey of creatively expressing herself. Smrita Jain believes that luck plays tiny little percentage. Ultimately, it is your hard work and it is love for all colors that has brought her here. With lots and lots of good wishes, thank you very much for joining
thank
us.
Thank you. Smrita. Thank you so much.
Such a pleasure talking to someone who inspires in embracing life in its totality with all that you have. With good wishes for her and lots of good wishes, as well as thanks for you for being with us. This is Ashok Vyas.